To get a better idea of how a lens works on a camera, first let's look at how your eye works. Lenses in a camera, whether it's digital or film, work the same way your eye does. Light and an image are passed into the eye from the outer cornea. It then passes into the iris. This is the part of the eye that can open or contract to allow more light in or keep light out. The image is then passed into the lens, where it's projected upside down onto the back of your optic nerve. If the image is out of focus, the lens can flex a little with the help of some very special muscles inside your eye. This will correct the blurry picture. If you're like me and you need glasses, it means that no matter how much your lens tries to fix the focus, the image is blurry on the back of your eye, and you need a set of corrective lenses to help your eye's internal lens work properly. Your brain corrects the upside down image to make a right side up image. At least that's how we see it. A camera works the same way. Light is passed into a lens where it must be focused, and it is then projected onto either a film sensor or actual film itself. The focal length of a lens is defined as the distance in millimeters from the optical center of the lens to the focal point, which is located on the sensor or film if the subject is in focus. The camera lens projects part of the scene onto the film or the sensor. The field of view is determined by the angle of view from the lens out to the scene and can be measured horizontally or vertically. The field of view associated with focal length is usually based on the 35mm film photography format, given the popularity of this format over other formats. When you look at the front of the lens, it gives you a lot of information about the lens. It tells you who the manufacturer was. The 50mm is the lens's focal length, and the f1.7 is its maximum aperture. It tells you where the lens was manufactured, and it tells you the filter size, or the diameter across this way, of the size of the lens. This lens is an example of a lens that has an adjustable focal length. The lens's focal length will change as the barrel is rotated and the lens gets larger. Here it's at 100mm. When I rotate it and the lens gets longer, it goes to 300mm. So this would be an example of a zoom lens, because you can zoom into the action and then zoom back out. If you are a filmmaker, you had some choices. One of your options was to buy a camera that had a fixed lens. This 16mm camera has one lens. Other cameras had the ability to use up to three different lenses. This was a big benefit for the filmmaker because he could just easily switch between lenses depending on the shot. Your other option was to have a camera that had removable mounts and different types of lenses, and this meant that you had to carry all of the lenses with you and then change them depending on the type of shot you wanted to make. This is an example of a fisheye lens. It's got such a wide angle of view, you can even see my shadow in the picture. This would be the equivalent of about a 5mm lens. Very wide. This is a 15mm wide angle lens. This is 25mm. This is 50mm. This is 100mm. This is 150mm. This is 250mm. And this is 400mm. With the Steadicam off, you can almost see very small vibrations because the zoom is so great. The vibrations are larger because the zoom is larger. This is a macro lens used for extreme close-ups. It has such high resolution on it, you can actually see the individual specks of pollen on the flower. The camera's about 1 inch away from the flower. Lens flare is a term that's used to describe these small reflections of light that appear in the lens. This is because the sun is right there, and I'm shooting almost directly into it. When I just shade my hand over the sun as it hits the lens, you can see the lights disappear. This is sometimes an undesirable effect for filmmakers, so what they do is they use something called a lens hood. When you look at a movie camera, the box in front of the lens is the lens hood. This is a lens hood.
If I position this over the lens, you notice it immediately makes the small dots disappear. If I remove the lens hood, the dots come back. It's because this flower-shaped design blocks the light from coming into the side of the lens and creating the lens flare.
Simply put, depth of field is the description of how much of the image is in focus. Depth of field is used to emphasize or de-emphasize a subject in a movie shot. It is controlled by the lens aperture. The aperture is similar to your eye's iris, and it allows how much light is let into the lens and how much light is sent to the film or sensor. Often referred to as an f-stop, the aperture may be fixed or adjustable depending on the lens complexity and construction. Here we see some common f-stop examples of a lens. The larger the f-stop number, the smaller the aperture in the lens. F2 is much larger than, say, F16. Some lenses can have an f-stop as low as 0.5 and as high as 50. The design of the lens helps control the depth of field and can, in turn, affect the entire composition of a shot. A smaller opening or larger f-stop number will mean a shorter depth of field. Less light is needed because the lens has a larger opening. In this example, the car is in focus with a very short depth of field. However, as the car is moved about a foot away, it's out of focus. Look at how the house and the trees in the background are totally out of focus. This was done with a macro lens and an f-stop of 4.5. It is an example of a short depth of field. The larger the f-stop, the smaller the aperture, the more of the picture will be in focus, and it will have a greater depth of field. More light is needed because the lens has a smaller opening. On the left is your typical camcorder with a very small aperture. On the right, the same type of camera, but with a lens that costs far more than the stock one that came with the original camera. If you've ever wondered why your small camcorder or point-and-shoot camera can't take the same pictures and get a nice blurry background, it's because the optics are so small. In the movie Citizen Kane, there's a famous scene where young Kane is playing outside in the snow. As the camera zooms out, we see his mother signing his adoption papers. This is an excellent example of deep focus cinematography. In this scene, there are three main planes. Usually, a director would focus on the foreground, in this case, the mother signing the paper, and the rest of the plane would be out of focus. However, in this scene, all three planes, the mother in the front, the father in the door, and the young Kane outside the window, are all in focus. Deep focus was a very big deal in the field of cinema because it gave the audience a choice of where to look at rather than limiting their attention to the focus. However, this technique was difficult to achieve since the camera had to move through so many different planes and light sources. It has an exceptionally large depth of field. So now hopefully you have a better idea of some of the more technical aspects involved with filmmaking. Thanks for watching, and hope you enjoyed my project.